We are Catholic Extension, and we have a story to tell. For the next half hour, and throughout this series, we'll share inspiring stories of faith, stories of people who are making a difference in our church, people who are building faith, inspiring hope, and igniting change. For over 100 years, the mission of Catholic Extension has been to build up the Catholic Church in the poorest communities of the United States. We serve over 90 of the 195 dioceses from the farthest reaches of Alaska to the Gulf Coast of Florida. We call these mission dioceses, where economic resources are scarce, but the people are rich in faith. This episode of Catholic Extension is focused on some of the extraordinary people we support who are following Pope Francis's call to reach out, to spread the good news. We'll look at creative evangelization on the front line where people of deep conviction are igniting change. And we'll also travel to mission dioceses across the country where we'll celebrate the Mother of God and witness the Feast of Our Lady of Guadalupe, a beautiful blending of tradition and devotion. But first we'll visit Catholic missions on Native American reservations to look at our church adapting and reaching out at the margins of our society, to share in the gifts Native Americans bring to our church. Pope Francis has said that he dreams of a missionary option, that is, a missionary impulse capable of transforming everything. Making this dream a reality among the ancestral peoples of our nation inspires Catholic Extension support of Native American ministries.
South Dakota is a country of contrast. We have, at times, 18 below zero, and we can have 110 in the summertime, and we almost always have wind, and the wind blows where it wills, and you better learn to adjust. Adjust is the big word out here.
What is important is to change the way we did missionary work in the past. So you can't just do missionary work by coming in, presenting the gospel, teaching catechism, erecting churches, and having mass. Today's missionary activity has to have a much broader base. The first thing to do is to analyze what are the needs of people, where are they hurting, and how can the church minister to those hurting individuals or that hurting community.
There's not one person that suicide has not touched here on this reservation. It is such a profound problem. In 2006, when it became a real tragedy, we were 17 times the national rate of suicide. At that point, I think CBS News declared that we had the number one suicide rate in the world.
I lost a sister to suicide, a brother to suicide, and my grandson's mother to suicide. I'm taking care of my grandson today, who is 9 years old. You know, he's my inspiration here at St. Francis Mission. The faith is what will,
I can't take that on by myself.
Basically what will carry me through all these types of situations and give me the strength and positive outlook to help people. If those kinds of thoughts are crossing their mind, I can be there to support them through that.
Some of the challenges that our youth here on the reservation face would be alcohol, drug abuse, poverty, and having no higher power.
So our first piece is a healing ministry. And what we've tried to do here at St. Francis is to first of all address alcoholism. We have two very strong recovery centers and a family recovery program that's been very successful. But it aims at healing family members. Now the other piece of that is these programs, as well as the spiritual programs that we run, have to be headed by Native people.
My greatest hope and dream for all the young people is for them to learn more about God and about Jesus, and I want them to be able to learn it and to live it and to practice. It inspires them to be better people. They'll want to go on to school. They'll want to do better for their community and for our people. I mean, I'm hoping that, you know, that we're making a difference by teaching them.
Part of my job is not just meeting their needs. Their greatest need is for me to remind them who they are. That as Native Americans, they are a gifted, privileged people. And to uphold their culture and to get them to recognize you don't have to be less Native to be a good Catholic. I want to do justice. I want to do something that makes a difference, that changes the situation at Red Lake. But they can teach the other parishes what it means to be Catholic.
Jesus is the rock, my rock.
To have a church, you know, where the priest can say Mass in the camp and where they can, where we can use the things of their tradition, the drum and so forth. When you bring the two together, there's just a richness there for me as well. I mean, when I go to the ceremonies, that's where I pray best. John Paul II came to Phoenix for the Tekakwitha Conference. That's the National Native Americans. He asked forgiveness of the Native Americans for not understanding and giving them a hard time for their spirituality. And would they forgive us? And would they go back and embrace it? I was there, and that was huge for me, and I think for the people.
Father Eddie, gosh, he's made a lot of good, you know, impression on me and my family. You know, we put the two together, and I think we're stronger. My family is stronger because of it, spiritually.
The faith here of the people is very deep. And I think part of it is because, you know, the faith is so important to them out here. So it's been a blessing for me to be with the people, to see their faith, to see their forgiveness. And so I really learned from them about forgiveness and about prayer.
For over 100 years, Catholic Extension has supported efforts that inspire hope among our Native American brothers and sisters. These ministries are central to our calling, and they're a heartfelt expression of our Catholic faith. The Feast of Our Lady of Guadalupe, observed across the Americas, brings countless gifts to our faith tradition. Throughout the centuries, the Church has turned to the Blessed Virgin in order to come closer to Christ, honoring her as the Mother of God, looking to her as a model of perfect discipleship, and asking for her intercession with her Son on our behalf. The Feast of Our Lady of Guadalupe brings people to the Church in a joyous celebration of tradition, renewal, and profound devotion.
The message of Guadalupe is, yes, how can we be together in our culture and celebrate our culture and celebrate Mass in our language, but how can we also come together as a larger family?
It's us gathered here around our mother at all different ages and trying to truly be inclusive and celebrate the diversity of age groups and languages and ethnicities.
Juan Diego was waking up very early in the morning to go to catechism class. And as he's passing this little hill of Tepeyac, he hears music. And so he goes to see what the deal is. And as he goes up the hill, he encounters this beautiful woman dressed in light. I mean, just beautifully dazzling colors. And she introduces herself to him as the Virgin Mary, but then says that she is the mother of the God of great truth, the God of all people, the creator of heaven and earth. Essentially, she asks him to go to the Bishop of Mexico and that there be a temple built here where she could gather people together, where she could console them, where she could comfort them, where she could heal them, where she could be their mother. The beautiful story of Our Lady of Guadalupe says that she took the flowers and she arranged them in his tilma. We'd probably call it a poncho or this garment that he's wearing. And she arranges the flowers in his garment. She closes and says, take these to the bishop. So he goes to the bishop. He says, I have the sign that Our Lady wants you to have. He opens his tilma And there, with the flowers that fall out of it, is the beautiful image of Our Lady of Guadalupe that we see today.
The Feast of Our Lady of Guadalupe is witnessed by many communities, each bringing their own traditions to the celebration. For example, in Las Cruces, New Mexico, St. Juan Diego's journey up the mountain to encounter Our Lady of Guadalupe is commemorated by people of great faith, some of them on their knees or carrying crosses. Confessions are heard. People come to pay tribute for the hardships and joys in their lives before a mass is held on the mountaintop.
I know a lot of people who come to this celebration, they will come and offer roses for very specific needs, sometimes for, you know, an elderly person that is ill that couldn't be here, or for unity and healing.
They bring pain, they bring everything, and put it to her that way she can take it to her son.
Mary comes with her hands joined like this, which is a symbol for the indigenous people of offering, and she comes to offer her son.
Mary played a central role, but always a role that was bringing people to Jesus.
We know our mother's mission is take us to her son.
Guadalupe has such appeal, not just among Mexican people, but among Hispanics in general, but then also other immigrant groups like recent African immigrants. So she is a symbol, a mother for all.
It's a bishop's dream to see the excitement, the spark in their eyes is a spark of faith, the excitement. They're here because of Mary.
This example of Mary as the first evangelizer is a message for us, not just 500 years ago, but in our quest right now, in our call as church, to not just preach good news. You could talk about good news, but to be good news. Not just to go to church, but to be the church. When we see this image of Our Lady of Guadalupe, it has a force beyond words. And so if she's my mother, I must be somebody. I must have some place in the society. I must have dignity.
Celebrating the Mother of God in this beautiful custom is an inspiring example of different people and cultures coming together to share the good news as one Catholic Church. Creative evangelization extends the church to new people in unlikely places, sharing our faith by example, witnessing rather than proselytizing, living by Christ's teachings, and sharing the joy of the gospel. Catholic Extension supports dynamic ministries that bring the church to forgotten people so that we all may share in Christ's love.
A la misión, 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 a la misión, a la misión, misión, misión. A la misión, misión, misión. A la misión, misión, misión. A la misión.
Más fuerte para ellos.
A la
misión, misión, misión. A la misión, misión, misión. A la misión.
Buenas tardes, somos misioneros católicos. Hola.
Tenemos un plan de misión parroquial estructurado y ahorita ya un poquito motivando a los grupos para que se integren a participar en esta evangelización de casa en casa.
Más que nada al ministerio que nos acogió y ahora estamos también nosotros aquí con ellos ayudando a que las personas también sientan lo que Jesucristo está vivo, está entre nosotros.
To go out to every single household. To knock doors, to introduce ourselves, to listen to the people, trying to understand first, and later try to be understood.
It works. Coming, knocking the doors, it works. Because now it's a lot of teenagers coming to the church. Before it was just one or three. Right now we have 25 same age like my daughter, 17, 18, and they're involved.
Y nosotros como católicos ya queremos atender la llamada del Papa de salir a evangelizar hacia afuera, que no seamos una iglesia dormida, sino que salgamos a las familias más alejadas, a las periferias donde necesitan de nuestra presencia como católicos, que ya no estemos dormidos, que seamos una iglesia activa, viva.
Ministries that adapt to local culture and regional realities have an extraordinary effect on the communities that they serve. In McKee, Kentucky, St. Paul's Mission Church evangelizes by sharing Christ's love, working to turn poverty around, and turning people to the church.
I was graduated from college in 2004 and really wanted to do mission work to solidify what it meant for me to be a Catholic. A lot of my passion for service and for my faith comes from individual people in my life. I'm returning the gifts that God's given me and that they've given me. The mountains are beautiful, but they're very isolating as well. The richness is definitely the focus on faith and family. Something that we've always continued to do is to respond to the need, whether it was starting the food bank out of a ministry of the church or a transit service to get people to the doctors because we're 40 minutes from a hospital.
St. Paul Church has made a tremendous difference in Jackson County.
Our thrift store, it provides a means for material goods, clothes, household items. It also provides a job in the county, at least a part-time job. And then we have a core of volunteers that help out there.
I love to help people. I've done it all my life.
The attic is totally financially self-sufficient. So once all those bills are paid, that's a lot of what we use for our outreach budget. Just by trying to be the hands and feet of Christ and just to respond to the need, we've been able to build great relationships and a great reputation for being compassionate servants.
St. Paul's it's a great place to be. I love going down there and helping Rebecca. I mean, she's a great person. She will help anybody.
Whatever help they need, we can help them and then they help us.
This morning, we had an event called I Heart Art Event, and we actually did it in conjunction with McKee Baptist Church. They've got a great number of kids that come to our vacation Bible school, and so some of our parish kids and some of their kids, we all got together. So they painted this beautiful mural of a tree, and on the trunk of the tree, it says, "I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me."
Jesus loves us.
I was a part of writing the proposal to land a major manufacturing company in this community so that people have permanent jobs. It's always been there in my mind and in my heart that this is where I need to be and this is what I need to be doing.
Service has just always been something I've been passionate about. A lot of people will see God in nature or different things, and I just see Him in people and the power to change. I have to pass it on. I just am a full believer that, you know, we can love because God loved us first.
When things are going on with my family and I'm needing to share things with God, I come here and lay it down at His feet and give it to Him. That's why this place is special to me.
From the mountains to the marketplace, being more missionary, meeting people where they are, calls a group of innovative Capuchin priests and the Bishop of Colorado Springs to operate a Catholic church at, of all places, a shopping mall.
Let's take Christ as best we can right to where people are. And for better or worse, a lot of them are shopping. Think of a church, just think of it though, in the middle of a shopping mall.
This is the perfect place for evangelization because it's where the people are. It's the marketplace. It's where they come.
Where else would Jesus be but in the marketplace? So, I mean, it's an ideal setting.
The original plan for the Capuchins was to have a downtown parish and offer confessions throughout the day. When we talked to Bishop Hannafin, he felt that there was not a place that had enough foot traffic and that there would be better foot traffic at a mall.
The Capuchin ideal is to go and be and work among the people.
People of all faiths come in here. They ask if they can come in and just sit and meditate. So it's welcoming to everybody.
What's special about the Catholic Center is that it is a public outreach of the Catholic Church in an area that is predominantly non-Catholic.
Here, it's morning till night, 6 days a week, the new evangelization is going on, and that's just irreplaceable.
The Catholic Center, as far as I'm concerned, has been a total blessing. Here you have a chapel in the mall, and not only is it in the mall, but it's available.
Because I can come here whenever. I don't have to wait till Saturday to have a priest hear my confession. I can go right now.
I think in our world today, we have to be looking for new ways to reach out to people. We can't be sitting waiting for them to come to us. We have to get out there where we can be seen and be seen as a welcoming church, a welcoming community.
The Holy Father is a people person, and he wants to make the church more available to the people and more human, if you will, as well as a sanctifying fellowship. And so we think we're doing that here. We do.
Creative evangelization takes many forms. Reaching out to people also means reaching out through the media. I recently spoke with Father Dave Dwyer, host of the Busted Halo satellite radio show. Father Dave combines an extensive background in radio and television with his own deep faith, seeking to reconnect young adults with their Catholic faith.
I'm glad that you got communion, because God bless you guys.
The Catholic Channel, Sirius XM 129, presents the Busted Halo Show with Father Dave Dwyer.
Tell me, first of all, just because it's curious, why Busted Halo?
We're all sinners, so that's what we say with Busted Halo. Mm-hmm. We're all sinners, but we're on a journey toward God, and God is not happy for us merely to say, oh, well, I'm a sinner, I'm not going to try. So the idea is we're supposed to be polishing up the halos. Yeah. We're supposed to be repairing them a little bit. That's the idea. And eventually that we would all be part of the kingdom of saints, right?
Right. And you're speaking primarily to this kind of millennial generation, these young adults. What are you learning about the millennial generation?
Probably the most significant thing for us to know as those who reach out on behalf of church is that in larger and larger chunks, every time they do a survey, every year or so, that a young generation is saying that they don't identify with church, with religion, with the institution. The challenge is to first kind of connect with people on a level of identity and to at least kind of not walk, we're not talking about walking in the door of church. We're talking about walking in the door of saying I am or I was or I was raised or whatever it is, but to somehow wear that Catholic name tag at least, and then to hopefully draw them in.
And in terms of drawing them in, what have you found in your experiences that open up the doors to them, to this kind of deeper conversations?
The thing that is more successful than anything else is peers. You see what your friends said by looking at the stars they put on Yelp or the fact that they recommended something on their own social media. So really, this is a generation that we, and by that I don't just mean the church, I mean any institution, I mean marketing people are trying to figure out how to do this too, right, that we don't reach by the man or the institution trying to deign to reach out.
888-322-8465. It is a What Did You Hear Monday?
Part of our work is what we might call pre-evangelization.
Yes.
I would say similar to the work of Catholic Extension, where a lot of what you do is plant churches. You begin, you make the seeds to potentially grow. Mm-hmm. So we don't always, in our work with website, with social media, even with podcasts or radio, see the final end of somebody walking into church and saying, yay, I'm home. So what people tell us is that we can be a source of Catholic joy, as well as learning a little bit about the faith, but also reaffirming their own faith in the church. Sometimes their local parish or the pastor changes and they're frustrated by that, or the music ministry wasn't great this week, or the homily wasn't good, but we can also be another source of Catholicism in their lives, and that's more than I could hope for.
This evening on the Busted Halo Show, of course we answer your questions of faith, as we do each and every evening.
Creative evangelization, using the technology of the times and reaching out to those at the margins of our society, have been a part of the mission of Catholic Extension since it was founded by Father Francis Clement Kelly. From day one, he creatively shared our faith in the press, in magazines, in books, even in motor coaches and rail cars, bringing the good news to people in innovative and compelling ways. The transformative power of faith at work in Native American ministries, celebrating Our Lady of Guadalupe, and creative evangelization, all examples of our church opening its doors and becoming more missionary. By supporting Catholic Extension and the inspired faith leaders who are helping people to live their deepest truth, we too can fully realize what it means to be the people of God. I hope you've been inspired by the stories we've brought to you today, and I pray that these stories will encourage you to follow the call of Pope Francis, to reach out to those in need, and to evangelize by sharing the joy of Christ's love. What an exciting time it is to be a Catholic in our country. My deepest thanks to the generous donors of Catholic Extension, and to learn how you too can become a part of what the Pope is asking us to do, visit our website at catholicextension.org. I look forward to the next time we will meet here on Catholic Extension, where we will continue to bring you stories that show you how we build faith, inspire hope, and ignite change across our great country. May God bless you and all whom you love.